Welcome to the Medical Minimus Podcast, your source for memory techniques and accelerated learning in higher education. Now, here's your host, Chase DeMarco.
Introduce the audience to yourself a little bit, and what got you into memory training and your first championship?
Yeah, thanks for having me on the show. Always happy to help others with their memories. I started, you know, with just an average memory and kind of got into the world of memory because I was fascinated by the brain and watching my grandmother kind of deteriorate from Alzheimer's disease that led me to really kind of discover the U.S. Memory Championship and memory techniques in general. And when I started trying them, you know, I was a bit skeptical at first, but quickly realized that they work and I was hooked. And I just wanted to get better and better. And ever since then, that was about almost 10 years ago now, I've just been working towards a better memory.
Wow, that's a great story. I know that when I first started learning, I also was very skeptical. I thought I hadn't learned about these in my education background. I hadn't learned them in my medical background. There can't be much to it, but there really is. I've noticed a huge difference, and that's great. I know I've heard on a few other podcasts I've heard you interviewed on that you have a lot to do with Alzheimer's research, and that was a big interest for getting you into this. Can you go into that a little bit more?
Yeah. So like I said, my grandmother suffered from Alzheimer's, and after it started as a personal journey, right? So I just wanted to do this for myself, kind of improve my own memory so that that wouldn't happen to me down the road. But after a while, you know, learning that a lot of people actually don't know anything about these techniques or about brain health. A lot of people don't really consider brain health as something they should value or put ahead of other things in their life. Kind of said, okay, I should probably somehow bring this back to the people and try to educate as many people as I can about brain health and these techniques. So I started a charity called Climb4Memory, which combined another passion of mine, which is climbing, and thought, okay, this might be a good way to get people to pay attention, learn a thing or two, and hopefully walk away with some, you know, brain health tips and a bit of a more awareness of Alzheimer's and what it means to have a healthy mind.
I actually just completed my first 14er a few months ago. For the audience that doesn't know, 14er is anything that's over 14,000 altitude. So that was pretty tricky. I know you've tried
Which one? Few times.
It was Gray's and Torrey's in Colorado.
Those are awesome ones. Nice.
I definitely want to come back to the Climb4Memory and the extreme memory challenge you have. But before we go into that topic, I know there is something interesting, and I guess it's a little, there's conflicting data right now as far as memory training, developing the hippocampus, making it larger or not, and how that might combat things like Alzheimer's and memory deterioration.
Yeah. So I've kind of heard both things. I've worked closely with some neuroscientists who, you know, say that when you train your memory, you grow the size of your hippocampus. And then also, as you get older, your hippocampus shrinks. It's just a natural part of the aging. And this is kind of something that can help kind of bring on Alzheimer's. It's not the only factor, but it can help. So the argument goes is that if you train your memory, you're kind of fighting against that natural age shrinkage of your hippocampus. So I was once told that, you know, if you live long enough, you will get Alzheimer's, you know, that's just kind of what will happen with the brain. But if you have a larger than average hippocampus and you work to kind of grow that, you can kind of stave off that potential cognitive decline.
Great. Just another reason to really maybe concentrate on building your memory and building your techniques to develop your long-term memories. So with Climb4Memory, I believe last I heard you've tried Everest 3 times, was it?
Yeah, man. The more I add numbers to that, it sounds like embarrassing. I wish I could say that I've summited Everest, but no, I've attempted it 3 times. It's been a goal of mine for almost 10 years now to stand on the top of the world, and I've come excruciatingly close those 3 times. And yeah, I mean, it started off, the main purpose of it is to raise awareness for the disease, but also it's a personal challenge, and it's been a dream of mine for many, many years. Yeah, it's one of these goals that I'm always chipping away at, trying to find a way to get back there in the next year to finally finish it off.
Well, you know, something like that, especially, the only way you fail is by not trying. Not summiting is not the failure point there. That's just amazing. Just to get there and prepare for it, to train for it, and actually start climbing that must be quite exhilarating.
Yeah, I mean, I'm so thankful and lucky, I think, to have been given the opportunity to be able to be there even once. It's this incredible place. It's not easy to get to in terms of, you know, converging your life and your responsibilities to be able to do that. Also your health and your training, and also the financial commitment. So yeah, I'm lucky to have had those 3 experiences, and they're amazing experiences regardless of whether I summited or not. you walk away with incredible memories and an amazing journey, you know?
Mm-hmm. I can only imagine. And just a 14er was hard enough.
Right? You can imagine, right? It's double that, right?
Yeah.
There's not to take away from a 14er. Some of those 14ers are very challenging. You should be very proud. Those are awesome.
Yeah, I was pretty lightheaded by the time we got to the top and with the thin air and everything.
Yeah.
So let's segue this into a little more of the student and parent population. Now, this is going to be a different interview than some of the others I've done because it's mostly concentrating on the medical student and higher education population. Sure. But especially with your new book and knowing that a lot of physicians either currently are or plan on being parents, I did want to add in the aspect of training for kids. And that is a great topic since your new book is related to that, correct?
Yep. So, well, I have a book that I wrote a couple of years ago. It's a children's kind of picture book, teaches a very basic memory technique. But recently, this past year, my book was published. It's for adults. But I'm doing a version of that book for kind of younger kids, which will be out in 2020. So, and I also had a child. So, obviously, training kids these techniques is in the front of my mind. Yeah.
Oh, great. I guess I mixed up the dates there, but I remember specifically something about the kids book. I'm not sure if I was thinking the original or the new one coming out, but that's
probably the original one. Yeah.
Okay. I think that's very interesting because not only are these techniques seeming to develop more of a popular following and more scientific backing, but if you could have learned these techniques when you were a kid, imagine where you would be now.
Yeah, I think that all the time because I learned this even after grad school. Just finishing grad school is when I learned this stuff. And it's like, man, if I had this in grad school, I was going into grad school or into my undergraduate, things would have been totally different. Not that I did bad or anything, but it would have made my life easier.
Exactly.
But yeah, it's something I wish, and I constantly am trying to do this or work towards this being the case, that these are things that are taught to kids from the start. Maybe this is even the first thing that they're taught in schools, right? Because everything they're taught, you're told to do as a kid in school is memorize your times tables, memorize the alphabet, memorize the presidents, right? Obviously, there's more context that you learn about them, but it starts with memorization. So if we can teach our kids how to have these tools, these memory tools that are just habit, and they know how to use them given any memorization task, imagine how much time that would free them up and how it would make people who struggle or have learning disabilities, how much easier it would be for them to actually focus on learning rather than the memorization part, right?
And they're so much more creative that I assume it would be much easier for them to develop these tools early on and have many more years to develop them, where it's a little harder when you're learning after grad school, not really sure what to do with it.
Yeah. And the thing is with kids, it's like they have such a playful imagination. They want to be thinking of funny, silly, playful things. And that's all memory techniques are, is you're taking these complicated things and turning it into stuff that's really fun and attractive to you. And so we can do that, you know, with kids, which shouldn't be too hard. I think that's going to make a world of a difference in the education system.
I definitely agree. Now, before we go into some of the more definitive tools and techniques for the students, I did want to ask about something I heard from previous interview with you about how memory techniques have changed and evolved over the past few years and maybe where they might be going from here.
Yeah, I mean, these championships that exist, the world championships, the U.S. championships, have been around about 20 to 25 years. And, you know, the very first one, if you look at the scores, they might still be impressive to the average person. But, you know, if you're looking at the records and the scores today, it's laughable. It doesn't even seem that impressive. You know, back then, a psychologist might have looked at that and been like, you know, you can't really, there's not really much more room for improvement. The memory can only do so much. But here we are 25 years later, and the records keep getting broken. And it's incredible what's possible. Even what I thought when I started, what was going to be the limit has been shattered, you know? And so now you think, okay, that's the limit, right? In 10 years, you can imagine that would probably even be shattered too. So it's really incredible what keeps being pushed. And it just shows you that it's just, memory is just another skill, you know, like any other thing that a bunch of people try to get better at, you're eventually going to get someone who trains harder with a better strategy and finds a way to push the limit.
I was recently reading Peak by Anders Ericsson, and I know there's some connection between him and Joshua Foer, Moonwalking with Einstein author, but he was talking about how over the years, all athletic boundaries have been shattered. And then one of his test subjects was studying memory and just, I think, got up to around 80 different digits that he can memorize, something like that. And that was really great at the time, because before that, he could only remember the 7 ± 2 rule. Yeah. And now we have hundreds, thousands. I forget what the number of memorizing pi is up to at this point, but it's insane.
Yeah. So that test was, I think, a spoken digit. So I think they give 1 digit per second or every 2 seconds. Mm-hmm. And you got to only hear it once, obviously. So think of that. Someone reciting a phone number to you, 1 digit at a time. Most people would have a hard time with that. You know, 7 to 10 digits with the area code might be hard. But so here, this guy in this test started being able to do just about that. And then by the end of it, was able to do about 80 digits in a row through just practicing every day. And so in the world championships, this event exists, the spoken one, and the record's about 450 digits. Right. Wow. So you think that's over 5 minutes of just listening to 1 digit being said every second, right? And no mistakes. So that's an impressive display of memory. But also there's different events of numbers. For example, memorizing as many digits read on a piece of paper for an hour. And the record, I think Alex Mullen had it with about 3,200 digits, but I think it was recently broken and it's about 3,400 digits.
Wow.
And I think the pi record is, I think official is in the 60,000s, but I've read about a Japanese guy. I think it's unofficial, but he was around 100,000.
I think I've read about that too. Yeah, that sounds insane. And for the audience, Alex Mullen was actually in our previous podcast episode, so please go back and listen to that.
Yeah.
Now, specifically, how you develop your visual markers is something I'm having a lot of trouble with, because much of the material I've read so far has to do with number strings or things that are not as relevant to, let's say, studying in school. So would you have any advice specifically for medicine, science-based topics that might not be really predominant in the literature, or something that's unique to you that might help students in these topics?
Yeah. So, I mean, in terms of what you're doing when you're using memory techniques is in general, you're taking something that's really complex, foreign, difficult, and trying to make it easy, right? For your brain to just soak up, right? So there's certain things that your brain just naturally wants to remember, right? You know, that childhood memory where you were in bliss, right? Having an ice cream on a sunny day, for whatever reason, you remember that memory like the back of your hand. Or the flip side, right? Where you had the most tragic or traumatic experience of your life, you probably remember tons of detail about that versus the everyday grind where you're doing almost the same thing every day, going to class, going to work, whatever. Those aren't so memorable because they're all about the same thing. Nothing really sets it apart. There's no real emotional uniqueness to it. So when you're memorizing these complicated drug names or symptoms of a disease or whatever you have to do in med school, a lot of them deal with very complicated words, a lot of information that's kind of number-based or very sciencey words. That stuff isn't stuff you just naturally absorb. So it's all about trying to take that stuff and come up with some weird emotionally charged marker or picture so that's easier to remember. I like to think of things that are very emotionally charged. So I like to make things funny, sad, grotesque, things that evoke a reaction from me internally, you know, and it's all simulated. It's not a real sadness or real anger. It's just kind of a thought about it. And it kind of pings you in a little way that makes it kind of stick out. So I always try to add that to the image, and also a little bit of movement. Having some kind of action or movement in the picture that I come up with tends to make it stick a lot better. If I find that I make it very static, I tend to not remember it very well.
That's a great point. I know that some of the material out there, and it's very limited when it comes to visual markers in medical training, but some out there, I think Picmonic and Sketchy Medicine would be the two big names. I'm not sure if you're familiar with those two companies.
No.
But they're very renowned. Students love them. But because it's someone else creating it, it doesn't evoke that same personal reaction, and it's not animated. So obviously, it's very difficult to interpret that for material for others to learn from. So I understand the limitations in creating that material. But I would like to sort of get students to realize that if they make their own and they make them more dynamic and less static, that it's going to provoke a longer-term memory for them.
Yeah. I mean, look, I get the idea that, you know, you maybe want to save time and use someone else's markers. And if somebody's already done all the work, it may be a quick way to do it. And they can possibly work and be really effective. And maybe even it's a starting point, right? But adding your own kind of secret sauce to it, right? can make a world of a difference, right? If you find that some of them aren't sticking quite well. As you said, I think the best markers or images for yourself are the ones that you come up with just because they're coming from you. But then again, yeah, you're going to have people who struggle with the creativity and they're be like, oh, I would have never thought of that one. That's a good one. I'm going to use that. So maybe a mix in between the two, right? Using those resources as a starting point and then adding a little more color and emotion.
That's a great point, mixing the two techniques. I have trouble with certain markers. Certain topics are very difficult to come up with your own original creative design, especially if you're not used to creating them or not used to that material. So maybe starting out with pre-made material, but then parts that you're still getting stuck on creating your own.
Yeah. I mean, a good example, I'm not a med student, so I don't know any good med examples, but let's say the presidents of the United States, right? Over the years, right? I've used it as an example, and I've had my own markers that I kind of throw out there as an example. And then I've heard other memory champions talk about their markers. And I'm like, oh, that's a good one for, you know, this president. I'm going to use that. But then, you know, what it comes down to is, sure, I'm using their image, but it's my version of it, right? So a good example is president number 3, which was Jefferson, right? So I used to think of a guy named Jeff, you know, which isn't very memorable. Or I used to think of Giraffe from the Toys R Us thing. I think his name was Jeffrey the Giraffe. So Jefferson, I think of a giraffe. Okay, fine. It's a bit of a stretch. But then I heard another memory guy, Ron White, he would say, Jefferson is Shefferson, chef. Think of a chef. I was like, oh, that rolls off the tongue super easily. Okay, so I have a chef now as my marker for Jefferson. But, you know, a chef is can be any things, right? It could be the guy you saw at the restaurant last night cooking your food. It could be your mom in an apron, right? It could be a guy, a big French guy with a mustache and a big hat baking bread, whatever. So that part comes from me, right? I think of whatever chef means to me, but I use that general idea of a marker from somebody else.
And then you have more visual options to choose from personally.
Yeah, exactly.
Actually, if you wouldn't mind, could you give an example of something, whether it be the presidents or something else, just a short memory list that you've used in the past to give the listeners an example of how to use some of these?
Yeah, I mean, we can continue off of the presidents since we're there. Okay. So, I mean, coming up with the visual markers is one step, and then the rest is how you store it, which, you know, you might place it in a memory palace or use some kind of linking, connecting the images together in a sequence so that you can remember the order. But for example, Washington would be your first president. So I come up with a marker for Washington. So I would think of like washing machine with a ton of apples in there, right? And why the apples? Well, because I connect it to Adams, which reminds me of an Adams apple. Okay, so I kind of combine those two presidents in one kind of connected image. So we have the washing ton and then apples, Adams apple. So there's Washington and Adams, right? And then out of the washing machine, you pull those, who's pulling out the apples? It's the chef, Jefferson. There's Jefferson, right? And so on and so on.
Okay, so just going from washing machine, apples in the washing machine, someone taking the apples out, you have the first three presidents right there in a quick dynamic visual marker that's easy to stick.
Yeah, and that's using the linking method there where I'm connecting one image to the next and that image to the next. It's one kind of solidified chain of images that helps you get the order straight.
Got it. So I could picture using that maybe for like a certain pathway in medicine where you need to remember the order things happen, the order from this product to this, you know, substrate to this next reaction. That might be a good method. Okay. So for any resources that our audience could be directed towards, do you have different resources for maybe beginners, since I'm assuming a lot of our audience is probably going to be fairly new to this material, and then maybe some for any advanced listeners?
Sure. I mean, I have to mention my book, Remember It, not to be the shameful plug, but I honestly think that, and I designed it this way, is that it's just a really, I think, easy read intro to these memory techniques with lots of practical examples. And I think that's what a lot of people look for is just these examples. It's like, yeah, I get the idea, come up with a picture, put it in a memory palace, whatever, attach it to a location, but can you do an example for me? You know, you just asked me to do one and that probably helped. So if I have a book filled with a ton of different examples for different situations, I think that helps people get further. So that's my book. It's called Remember It. It's available wherever you find books. And then Moonwalking with Einstein is also another great read and a very, very good, fun introduction to the world of memory. It's not too deep in how to do it, but it's a good introduction in the history of it and kind of gets you pumped about potentially using them for your own accelerated learning. What else? There's a bunch of resources online. Some that I train with, Memocamp is a website that has a lot of these memory championship events in one spot. I use that all the time. There's a few forums out there. But yeah, the magnetic memory is really good. Jonathan Levi's Super Learner courses are really good. Barbara Oakley has a course called Learning How to Learn on Coursera. And that is, I think, an awesome thing to check out. It's not, there are touches on memory, but it's about just learning how to learn. I think it's one of the best courses out there, honestly.
I think that was one of my first introductions to learning how to learn was her course.
Yeah, great.
We'll put links in the show notes for all of the resources you've mentioned, and great to see the different techniques and different courses, books, and other resources that students can learn some of these techniques if they're just starting off.
I should also say, I guess you also asked me for more advanced. There's a great forum that people can post on or look up answers to questions they have about what they're studying or trying to memorize, and it's on artofmemory.com. That's a great resource as well.
That could be useful. All right. So are there any parting thoughts or recommendations you have for students?
Yeah. I mean, I think the number one thing is to kind of be open-minded to this stuff. Some of it can kind of sound a bit kooky and weird, and maybe you're like, well, maybe it'd just be easier to memorize it rotely like I've been doing for my whole life. But you got to try it. Honestly, it'll change your life. It changed mine. Everybody I've talked to who's learned about memory techniques has changed their life and the way that they approach learning and memorization. So I really encourage, especially it being the new year, to try it and give it a shot.
And where can the audience find you and your community?
My website is nelsondellis.com. You can also find me on YouTube. I have a great channel with tons of videos with memory tips. I really like putting a lot of content on my YouTube channel. So that's typically where you'll find me.
And do you have any more upcoming projects in the works?
Like I said, I'm working on my children's book, which will be out next year. And then, yeah, I just have a few different memory projects, kind of personal ones. I don't know if I can talk about them yet, but yeah, always in general trying to advance memory techniques onto the world on a bigger scale.
Great. And I know that you were mentioning that it's hard to get examples for certain topics, and that's also why we have the Facebook group for the Medical Nemesis, a Medical Nemesis Mastermind group. So people can go in there and share specific examples for medical and science related topics. That's
awesome. Cool. So yeah, I didn't know that existed.
It's just starting, so join early.
Okay. Yeah,
I can send you a link for it too.
Please do.
Now, I like to finish off the episodes with what I call a walk down memory lane. So three quick questions for you. First, is there anything you wish that you could remember better?
Anything I wish I could memorize better? This is embarrassing to say, but probably, it's actually not that bad. Maybe more of what my wife says, which, you know, it's a stupid thing to say because I should be able to memorize that. After all, I'm a memory champion, but a lot of it comes down to attention. And it's not that I don't want to pay attention, but sometimes I'm just very busy with other things. So I guess it comes down to me. I should be paying more attention.
I think I need to make sure some family members of mine listen to this episode because they don't pay attention to anything.
There you go.
Second question. Looking back now, is there anything you would have changed about how you approached your memory training?
No, I'm really happy with how I got to where I am or where I was when I was winning. You know, it was a really self-exploratory kind of process, and I loved that. The only thing I guess I wish is that maybe I had higher, I wish that people were at a higher level at the time that I started, because I think I would have shot to that quicker. It's the level of competition now is insane, and I'm struggling to keep up. But I feel like if I was starting now and I had the same kind of veracity to be so good, I'd be there quicker, you know? Yeah.
Okay. And last question, is there anything you wish you did differently in your career or side gig so far?
Yeah, maybe I wish I had started, put myself out there more at the beginning. I was always very reluctant to kind of pitch myself or think I was worth this or that. But you learn in the business of anything, you know, half the time people are just bullshitting you, and that's how they get by. Not to say that they're bad, just saying like people promise and put themselves up there and out there. People buy it, and that's how they get gigs, and that's how they get better. And I remember at the beginning, I was so You know, I was like, yeah, I'm okay. I'm good at this stuff. I'm a decent speaker. I can explain it. But I was never like, I am this and I can rock your, you know, audience. You know, I should have. And for anyone who's getting into this kind of world, I encourage you to be that person. Be that obnoxious kind of person who says you are this. Own it. You know, I wish I had done that sooner.
Sound like a great speaker to me. I'd go to a show that you put on, speaking, lecturing. Well, Nelson, next time you go on a good climb, let me know. And if I have time, I'd love to go on with you sometime.
Definitely. Yeah. With Climb4Memory, we're actually organizing more kind of treks and climbs abroad. So a big one that we're doing every other year is Kilimanjaro. So if you'd like to do that, maybe next year.
Oh boy.
I'll keep you in mind.
I better start training now.
Yeah.
Well, Nelson Dellis, thank you so much for being on the show.
Yeah. Thanks for having me, Chase.